আসসালামু আলাইকুম প্রিয় দর্শক মন্ডলী, অ্যান্ড ওয়েলকাম টু আওয়ার রেগুলার শো পলিটিক্স অ্যান্ড বিয়ন্ড। এখানে আপনারা জানেন যে আমরা আলাপ করে থাকি অনলি অ্যাবাউট পলিটিক্স, ন্যাশনালি, লোকালি এবং ইন্টারন্যাশনালি। এবং আমাদের মেইন উদ্দেশ্য হচ্ছে এই প্রোগ্রামটাতে যে আপনাদেরকে পলিটিক্সের বিভিন্ন পলিসি এবং কি হচ্ছে পলিটিক্যাল এরিনাতে সেটা আপনাদেরকে জানানোর জন্য, এবং আপনি কিভাবে পলিটিক্সকে সুন্দর করতে পারেন এবং পলিটিক্স আপনাকে কিভাবে হেল্প করতে পারে সেগুলি নিয়ে আমরা এই প্রোগ্রামে আলাপ আলোচনা করে থাকি। আমি আমার মূল অনুষ্ঠানে যাওয়ার আগে আমি গত সপ্তাহের যে আমাদের কুইজ, সেই কুইজটা আমি ড্র করব এবং আমাদের যে আজকের যে কুইজ সেটাও ইন্ট্রোডিউস করব। তার আগে আমি আমার যে প্যানেলে যারা গেস্ট আছেন তাদেরকে আমি ইন্ট্রোডিউস করে দিচ্ছি। আমাদের আজকে আছেন আমাদের এক্স কাউন্সিলর, আপনারা অনেকেই চিনেন, উনি সুপরিচিত কাউন্সিলর এবং উনি একসময় মেয়র ছিলেন, ডেপুটি লিডার ছিলেন ইন দ্য লন্ডন বোর অফ চা হামলেটস, আমাদের সুপ্রিয় এক্স কাউন্সিলর মতিনুজ্জামান।
আসসালামু আলাইকুম, থ্যাংক ইউ সো মাচ ফর ইনভাইটিং মি ব্যাক মাহমুদ ভাই,
এন্ড থ্যাংক ইউ,
আসসালামু আলাইকুম টু ইওর দর্শক অ্যাজ ওয়েল।
থ্যাংক ইউ, থ্যাংক ইউ। এন্ড উই অলসো হ্যাভ অন মাই লেফট, মোস্ট পিপল উড নো হু রান ইন দ্য লাস্ট মেয়র ইলেকশন, অ্যান্ড অলসো হ্যাজ বিন দ্য চেয়ার অ্যান্ড দ্য ডেপুটি অফ দ্য বেথল গ্রিন অ্যান্ড বাউ অ্যাসোসিয়েশন, Mr. Chris Wilfred.
Hello there. Yeah, assalamu alaikum. Very good to be back.
I'm sorry, I forgot to mention that you are the candidate for Battle Green Bowl.
For Poplar and Limehouse.
Sorry, Poplar and Limehouse.
Yeah, yeah, recently selected. So very good to be back on the show, engaging viewers again. And yes, building on the mayoralty, I'm now running for Parliament in the south of the borough. So looking forward to a very tight and interesting election over the coming months.
Sure, sure. সেই দর্শক মন্ডলী, আমাদের মূল অনুষ্ঠানে যাওয়ার আগে আমি গত সপ্তাহের কুইজটা ড্র করব। গত সপ্তাহের কুইজ ছিল হু ইজ দি হেড অফ দ্য হেড অফ চার্চ অফ ইংল্যান্ড, অ্যান্ড দি আনসার ইজ দ্য কুইন। উইল জাস্ট সি হু হ্যাজ ওয়ান দ্য কুইজ। ইউ গোনা ডু দ্য পলিটিক্স, ওকে, আই'ল লেট ইউ, ইউ আর দ্য পিপিসি এনিওয়ে, সো দেয়ার ইউ গো।
Yes, so A Hack from Edinburgh.
Okay, Scott. Hug by apnar onushthan apnar purushkar amra apnake poshiye dibo. Ajke je quiz seta ektu pore apni niche scroll e ashbe, apnara pordate khyal korben. Ajker quiz hocche when did Greece declare independence from the Ottoman Empire? Was it A 1822, B 1922, C 1622? একটু পরে আমাদের স্ক্রিনে স্ক্রোলে আসবে, আপনারা এইটার উত্তর দিয়ে দেবেন আমাদের ইমেল অ্যাড্রেসে, সেটা হচ্ছে pnb@channelieurope.tv। ওকে দেন, আমাদের প্রথমে যে সেগমেন্ট সেটা যথারীতি হচ্ছে যে একটা পলিটিক্যাল ওপিনিয়ন, অ্যান্ড টুডে আইল বি আস্কিং ক্রিস অ্যাবাউট এ পলিটিক্যাল ওপিনিয়ন। ক্রিস, হোয়াট উড ইউ লাইক টু শেয়ার উইথ আস দ্যাটস বিন, you know, that's been capturing your mind and heart?
Well, I think it's very interesting that the winner of your quiz lives in Scotland, because leading on from the referendum, what we've seen is a huge growth in the SNP there, which feeds into a wider fragmentation right across Britain of the political landscape and the emergence of a whole host of a lot of different parties that are growing in popularity and the place they have to play. So I think the TV debates is a really critical hot topic issue, because it forces us not only to challenge what are the big issues at stake in the election, but also who should be engaging the public on this and who the public should be able to see in those debates.
So your pretty much your opinion is that, you know, the public debates, I think there are going to be three altogether.
Yes.
That's what the that's what my understanding is, and you feel that that's a good thing?
Yeah, I think it's a good thing. I think what's really important, though, is those debates reflect that fragmentation that's happening and have a diverse viewpoint. That's why I think the proposal that the Conservatives put to the table, saying we need, you know, potentially up to even seven leaders on there, is the right way forward, because, you know, it needs to reflect that diversity of opinion.
Let me put this to you, that, you know, there's a lot of hoorah about your leader not trying to, you know, trying to escape it and not trying to attend the debate. How true is that?
Well, you know, obviously we're leading up to an election. There's lots of people are going to doing that, but I think actually it's a genuinely the right decision he's taking, just to give people that chance. Yeah, yeah, join in the debate, see the diversity of opinion there, and say, actually, look, people's viewpoints in politics are changing. You need to have that diversity there. We do live in a pluralistic democracy. Therefore, give all those different voices a chance to be heard. And at the end of the day, your arguments, if they're the right ones, are going to shine through.
Sure.
A crowded
market. Let me ask Muhtarin Zaman, who's from the Labour. Muhtarin Bhai, do you think it's a good idea for your leader to participate in these debates?
Well, look, we will be in May. People have a choice to make a decision that will have a profound impact on the kind of Prime Minister that we will have and the values that that Prime Minister will have in serving the people of this country. And the TB debates and then what they say and how they say and what, and people will be able to judge the person that will be leading that. And my difference I have on this is that you need to have the people that are likely to be running or in coalition, whatever, running this country. Mm-hmm. And for the people to judge those individuals. What you don't have is 10 people.
So you're not in favour of the
having too many people who might be brilliant in talking and so on, but would never be at the top table on sitting down, making the decision for the country. And that's why having too many people doesn't allow people to be focused on the people that... And the airtime is so little, so you can't get much.
Is that your personal view, or is it the party's view to kind of have just the few leaders in the debate and not the other leaders?
Well, I think any party should basically. I mean, obviously, you shouldn't be doing it for political convenience, because if your TV debates are to give the public the opportunity to judge the individual on their policies, so what you do is allow the airtime that you have, which is not much, that are to grill those individuals on their policy.
I think that's why they have three.
But if you have too many people on the platform, you cannot get those that interaction. And if I was the prime minister, I could see the current prime minister wants everybody included so that he doesn't have to spend too much time being accountable for the decision he's
made. Those are valid points, but there's also the option for the broadcasters to expand the time or do more of the debates. Having your leader's rates as a leader falling like anything back in the Neil Kinnock days. So are you optimistic that he will do well in the debate?
Look, I mean, we know that the media is not in... because if you judge people by what they wear and how they look and so on...
They all wear suits and ties.
And most importantly, how they say things. I think one thing for us is that we are still ahead in the polls and we are a challenge, and that's the reason why there's a likely chance, most likely we will be, people, and we don't take anything for granted. People have a choice. And I know that a lot of people in this country from south, north, east, west, the decisions of the current government are impacting families and children, and they have a choice to be made.
Sure. We'll come to that. Let me just ask Chris. Chris. As Muhtarin said, that having too much people on the platform is going to be a bit chaotic, and a lot of the people might not have airtime and not give an answer properly. Is this why your leader is trying to do a escape and have the Greens, have the UKIPs, have the have everybody on so that he doesn't have to say much?
No, I think actually it does reflect. The coming election is a clear choice. And when we are talking about it, it's clear that none of the two historic major parties, it doesn't look like they're, the big thing. So people are talking about how we're going to form a government after the next election. Mm. And you've got people like the SNP, the Greens, Lib Dems saying, we do this deal with Labour or we would do that. Mm. Supply and demand relationships, that sort of thing. So these leaders, it may appear that they've not got that big power, could very well have a seat at the top table around the cabinet. And therefore, I think it is important and right that people have the right to question them or see them being challenged at this stage in the process, ahead of any negotiations after the general election. Mm. And I think that really does emphasise what is at stake here. It's a clear choice. Long-term plan, or chaos and confusion and a whole plethora of different people trying to do
things. Let me put a different question to both of you guys. That does it really matter that, you know, for 20 minutes or an hour you're seeing some, you know, these people on the TV? Altogether, you're going to see them for like maximum 6 hours debating over three debates. But does it really matter to the people who are going to actually vote? Does it really matter to them? Because if you look at historically, I mean, last debate, historically, we've seen that Nick Clegg done very well in the debates. His polling was really, really high. But when he came to government, he made a proper flop, isn't it? Because his policies were not efficient. They were not going through. They were not, you know. So does it really matter? These, I mean, it's all good to stand on a platform and say things.
I mean, if you want the honest, my honest opinion,
If
you've got the media against you, so what you say, only 2% is shown, then this is live debate. What you see is what people are seeing, what you're saying, and people...
The real deal.
Real deal. So they see, like, the next Prime Minister, or Ed Miliband, and they and people, if they... And there's an opportunity for the next Prime Minister to be, to do the deal through that. And I think we've got a lot to lose to have less time, because I think we don't get fair share in the national media for our leader for various reasons.
I think they and therefore get fair share for everybody.
But I'm talking about the TV. But but if you're splitting it between 6-7 people, then it is smaller. Yeah. And therefore, Ed's got a lot to lose by having less time, because he's got so much to say, because he doesn't get the airtime. Like, if you're currently a prime minister, you get to announce a lot of things that you're on the TV and news and stuff.
Yeah, I understand that. But what I'm trying to get here is that in the last debates, Nick Clegg came out very well. His policies was really good.
Yeah, he
got
well.
More MPs.
Yeah.
But as soon as he came to government, he didn't able to deliver what he was saying, you know, and people are done internally.
Well, I think the Lib Dems have to reflect on that. Yeah.
All these. Yeah. No, what I'm saying is that all these leaders coming on stage and saying things, does it really matter to us?
I think it does. Yeah, I think it does at the end of the day, because I think you're right to say over the last 5 years, people have their daily experience. They see the results on the table, in their pocket, that sort of thing. Look at their future and their prospects, and they form that opinion. And we all lead very busy lives. And to have that hour, 2 hour segment with those debates allows you to process in your busy life, have that chance to engage with that leader and see how they're setting out their stall. And I think that's really critical. And I think it does matter. People want the human touch. They want to see what people are saying. And they want to have that moment, you know, out of the Westminster bubble, on the TV
screen. The other debates we've seen, we're going to talk about Scotland anyway, but the Scottish referendum during that time, SNP, Alex Salmond was skyrocketing his polls, but then again, he didn't able to manage to get more than 35% of the referendum vote. You know, so, I mean, those things are in people's mind, in voters' mind, in very different ways. And now that we have at least experience of two major debates, how does that going to pan out on the people's mind, that another debate, another show? You know, does it really matter?
I think it does.
You were a counsellor.
But you
spoke in different platforms, and did it really matter?
Well, I think it can do you good. It can do you harm.
Right. Okay.
And therefore, you said it, like, you know, Nick Clegg did really well, and that's why he ended up getting more MPs. And shame that he did not deliver on some of the promises he made and things that he was saying connected with people. And the opportunity that he was given. But there are people who might not have any say in how the government is run, but they may say things which people like, and therefore that support, the votes, people say, actually, I like him because I like what he said.
It's good you say the word promise. I mean, Chris, do you think that the leaders, when they come on these debates, should they promise certain things? Like last time, Nick Clegg promised about tuition fee and he didn't able to deliver.
Yeah.
This time, Labour's promising U-turn on bedroom tax and capping the tuition fee. And David Cameron's promising the EU vote. So there are promises.
Yeah.
Do you think that these are sustainable promises?
I think some of these are. I think it's important that leaders do set out their pledge. But I think now we're entering a new era in British politics. And I think there has to be a degree of honesty with the electorate that, really honest with them, that actually, there might have to be deals made and that sort of thing. However, you need to set out the general direction you want to move in.
Yeah.
And the public themselves also need to be aware now, and I think they are after the whole Lib Dem tuition fee thing,
mm.
that not everything. So you need to adopt something that you agree with the direction they're going in
mm.
and then fit within that. I'll be very interested to hear what your viewers have to say about
yeah,
that
sure.
later on.
Viewers, after you the other program, do call us, put your question to our PPC here from Poplar and Limehouse and ex-councillor Martin Zaman, who's representing the Labour Party. But overall, I mean, the other groups like the Welsh and the Ireland
mm-hmm.
parties, what are they called?
Cymru.
They want to come. They're now saying that why are we left behind? SNP wants to join in. I think so far it's pretty much agreed. What, UKIP and Green? UKIP and Green.
Well, the Greens are now in the broadcasting.
Is UKIP also in? I think the UKIP's in.
UKIP.
Yeah, they are, yeah.
So we've got five parties, including Lib Dems.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much confirmed. But it's yet to see who else is going to join in.
Well, then obviously you've got the likes of Respect as well.
What are the chances of Respect
to
come
through?
Yeah, you know,
I think George Galloway has been commenting on this, you know.
Yes.
I don't know. Yeah. We're going to have to say...
Then go as far as Tarim is first.
Well, exactly.
You know,
I suppose, if they are going to declare for a general election,
EDL?
Do they need to... No, I don't
the
think
BNP
so.
Party?
No, I think there has to be a certain amount.
BNP is a credible party because they were in the EU, they were in the City Hall.
But I believe they've sort of been wiped out, haven't they? So, no, I don't...
But they're still a party.
I think an electoral presence, having an MP, having a certain share, and showing that you have a certain membership base, those are the way.
I mean,
it has to be a combination of factors.
I mean, on this note, I think you were right, that how far do you go? I mean, we talked about... as far as they're going to BNP, EDL and Tarim Risk First.
Well, I think if you go in that route, and that's the danger, I feel, and the people...
If you keep on expanding
and
your parameters.
I think the people of this country are not given the right opportunity to make the right judgments.
Yeah.
And I think that's why it's important to have the right people on the top table who might be likely to be making the, you know, as Chris said, the coalitions or whatever, having those people and then having those policies scrutinised. I think that's the way to go.
Now that the TV, the national channels TVs are going to do these debates, how do you feel about local debates? I mean,
I think that's more important, isn't it? I hope there is a whole host of local debates, and I really look forward to getting stuck into that.
But do you think that those are more important than the national debates? Because
it depends on the audience. I don't know. I think, you know, the national debate, that sets the tone for the future of your country.
Mm.
On a big strategic level, you know, we're living in a changing world, massive challenges, who's going to be my leader? I mean, at the local level, it's saying, who's going to look after my community immediately around me? So I think, you know, they're both important. The national one, obviously, on the big picture, it's got to be the big crunch.
They're pretty
the
much
local
talk about defence, international finance and international, you know...
Well, I mean, as Chris said, I mean, nationally is the picture, and then translating that to a local, how does it impact on the constituents that you're hoping to serve?
Yeah.
And then having that discussion and the debate, I think, Ahmed, I totally agree that, you know, having the debate, having the right people, you know, to represent you, to stand up for you, to be able to fight for your corner, and making sure that the opportunities that are there in the country or whoever is the Prime Minister, that person is able to maximise those opportunities for that area. And that's what MP or whatever, you know, should be doing.
Well, thank you, Motimbe, and thank you, Chris. We're going to go on a break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about Greece. Shri Darshak Mandali, our political opinion shunlen, and our ekta choto birote jacchi, birote theke eshe apnader sathe abar amra alap alochona korbo. Amader sathei thaken. Thank you. আসসালামু আলাইকুম সুই দর্শক মন্ডলী, ওয়েলকাম ব্যাক টু আওয়ার শো। যারা আমাদের সাথে এই মাত্র জয়েন করলেন তাদের জন্য বলছি যে আমাদের এই প্রোগ্রামটা হচ্ছে পলিটিক্সের উপরে, অ্যান্ড দ্য হোল রিজন অফ দিস প্রোগ্রাম ইজ হাউ পলিটিক্স ক্যান শেপ ইউ অ্যান্ড হাউ ইউ ক্যান শেপ পলিটিক্স। অন দিস সেগমেন্ট ওয়ে গোনা টক অ্যাবাউট গ্রিস অ্যান্ড ইটস পলিটিক্স অ্যান্ড ইটস ইকোনমি। বিফোর আই ডু দ্যাট, আই জাস্ট ওয়ান্ট টু রিমাইন্ড ইউ অ্যাবাউট আওয়ার কুইজ ফর টুডে, উইচ ইজ ওয়েন ডিড গ্রিস ডিক্লেয়ার ইন্ডিপেন্ডেন্স from the Ottoman Empire? Was it 1822, 1722, or 1622? Do email your answer to our email address on pnb@channelieurope.tv. Okay, we're going to talk about Greece and its politics and its economy. As you both know that, you know, they recently had an election, and the far left, virtually the Communist Party has, Syrgia has won the election. They had to do a coalition just for literally two seats. I think they had 149 and they needed 151. But they've done an interesting coalition with the far right. So it's a bit of a mixed bag there. But what do you think overall on the politics side of it? Did the politics follow the economy, or the economy followed the politics, and that's why we have this kind of a government in Greece?
Well, look, I mean, in any country election, I mean, sometimes people, when they go through huge challenges in their own lives, you know, the pain they experience because of the austerity measures, people, if they're not, they don't like what they are experiencing, they look for alternative, and the Syriza party was like an alternative for people. Wanted something different. They wanted to overcome what was being, you know, what they were experiencing. So we will change the route, we'll change the direction, and people looked at that an opportunity of hope, and this party obviously got a landslide.
But that's been, that hope's been going on for a while. I think this is the third government within 4 years. So that hope has been gone. What do you think? That you know, is the politics following economy, or economy following the politics?
First of all, what we have to say is what's happening in Greece and across the Southern Mediterranean is a tragedy. You are seeing, I've got a lot of Greek friends who have literally had to leave their country to pursue an opportunity in a life elsewhere. You've got a whole generation in Greece that have had to leave, whole generations that are used to a certain quality of standard of living. The economy is shattered, their whole way of life, and therefore you're actually really retreating back as a society. My friend recently went back to see his parents. They've had 50% cut in their pensions. People are burning furniture for heat and that sort of thing. So you're entering a crisis zone. So that is a real tragedy within the EU to happen. And I think what that has done is that has put people in a very desperate state. And it means that they're actually, because their government hasn't faced up to the tough decisions over time, they're now in this really bad situation, and they felt they've had to resort to Syriza. So I think it's a real tragedy.
When people are economically in a disarray, they would just vote anyway.
I think people start to feel, yeah, I think it really emphasizes the importance of having a responsible government that takes the tough decisions, puts a long-term plan in place, and ensures that you can ride the storm. Because the global economy is by no means out of the woods yet. We've taken a lot of tough decisions here, for instance, and my colleague will undoubtedly say, you know, it's been very hard on people, but, you know, we've come through. And if you look what's happened in Greece, I think that is a result of people not taking those decisions, or just that overwhelming frustration that has boiled through and come out.
Do you think it's going to have a knock-on effect on other countries?
Well, clearly, because it's part of the, we are all part of the European Union, and one of the things that Chris mentioned about...
But not part of the euro, though, but, you know, do you think will have a knock-on effect?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that I would say is that Greece depends on, like, you know, visitors and there's tourism. And when you have a country where you've got young people growing and, you know, the unemployment is, you know, in, I think, two figures, 25%, whatever... It's going to have generations who have not experienced work. I mean, it's a real challenge for that. And when you have instability, so when you have a new government, you get the investors, you get all these kind of people who put money in, you know, suddenly say, well, actually, if they're going to have a confrontation with the, you know, the European and the and there'll be a problem, or they might come out of the European Union. If that does happen, that instability, people who cash in, they take money out. Mm. That also impacts on the country, because that's what's happening now. I mean, you know, they're going to have the money now. The cash is taken out of the country because people think, well, what's going to happen? And if it doesn't happen, then I don't want to lose my money. Mm-hmm. So when there's uncertainty and
people just hold their money, they don't want to let it go.
So for example, I mean, you know, and it doesn't have its value. And then I just relate that to something, you know, like, or like, you know, when you have something, oh, we're going to have a referendum, then what you have, all these investors who invested in London and places who put in a lot of money, they think, well, actually, you know, is this the uncertainty? What happens is they cash in, you know, take the money out.
It's pretty much down to themselves how to deal with it. I mean, interestingly, you've all seen before the Greece election, Syria, the candidates were saying, we're going to come out of Euro. We don't want to pay this debt. We don't want to know it. We're going to come with the euro. But recently, the finance minister met George Osborne
yesterday. Yeah,
and he's saying
fly economy, which was very interesting.
And he's saying, and he's now saying the headline. He's saying that no, we won't come out of the euro, but we would negotiate and we would have bonds, selling bonds, and have looking at growth. So. Saying something earlier, we talked about people promising and saying things. I think it's only been a week, isn't it?
And that's the danger. Yeah. Well, that's the danger where you can have you know, somebody who comes and says, like, I will promise you this, I could do this, but in reality, that might not happen. But that's what connects with people, because that's what they want to hear. Yeah. And you have a government, I mean, who says, look, you know, we're going to come out of here. It's not going to practical. You know, you've got to, it's not going to be possible. You've got a debt. You cannot forfeit that because you'll go bankrupt if you did, and that's a danger. I mean, I feel.
I mean, in terms of their assets, they've pretty much auctioned them out anyway, all their services and everything. So they don't have any real-term income except for getting taxation, and people are not working. So how do you deal with this thing?
The ECB obviously announced a massive injection of funds recently. I think basically a lot of this hinges on the German position now, and they've got to say, look, Europe is in this state. We're already seeing, for instance, Spain, Portugal, there's been massive demonstrations in support of far-left policies, and I think it's time for radical decisions now about do we have to enter a two-track situation within the Eurozone itself.
The Greece is they borrowed over $3 trillion.
Oh, it's incredible.
So it's close to America. America's a bigger country. Yeah. So, I mean, even if they spread it out, saying that we want to spread it out over another 200 years instead of 50 or 60 years, still, you know, you can't really get the economy running.
Europe as a whole, we're very clear on this, is in need of reform. Yeah. And that's why we've agreed, you know, we're campaigning hard for this referendum in 2017 to give us time to renegotiate a reformed EU. I think actually we are entering a stage where we need radical solutions. I think the Germans are starting to accept that. I think people like France are. Italy, we haven't spoken about Italy, they've got huge problems. Greece, I think this result is going to be a catalyst for action. And I think changing and making people more open to reform is actually good. You know, it changes the situation and becomes more relevant to us as we enter the next stage of our relationship.
Given the recent history of the country, that they had so much changes in government, how optimistic are you that Syria is going to stick around?
Well, I don't know, as
for
you
the
said.
Term of the period.
They've already had 1 week. They're already in a coalition with the far right, and he's remaining on certain promises. Who knows? Who knows? We will see. But I think it just definitely demonstrates the need for a clear long-term plan, an ability to take the tough decisions that you need to do in a still very bad global situation. And I think it just reiterates the importance of that.
Viewers, if you're watching this, we would like to also hear from you and your point. And what do you think about the Greece and its politics and its economy, and how it's going to reflect over the Europe, and how it's going to reflect into UK? I mean, do you think that UK is going to suffer for this euro debt?
Obviously, clearly, I mean, they've asked some of the debt to be wiped out. I mean, if it does, then it comes from our public pockets, and that's not going to happen. I mean, clearly, we cannot set a precedent where people take loans and then they can basically come out and get them wiped off. It's not going to happen. That's not how the world works.
Yeah, in terms of the total loan, I don't think UK has substantial amount as German does. So, you know, it was slightly better, but there are chances of losing all that money, isn't it?
No, I think one of the things that we need to do is make sure that, you know, we trade with Greece as well, and there's businesses that are linked to Greece, and we need to make sure the Greece functions, because our export depends on some, our exports also impacts on that. Mm. So one of the key things for us is to ensure that a country, I mean, when you are part of a family, you know, it's part of the family, you have to see it like that. If it really, well, you know, if we are trying to compete with the rest of the world, because that's what the European Union is, that we come together and we will try to take, you know, try to make sure that we find a way to cut the world's cake and eat it. And that's the agenda. If that's the agenda, you don't let one of your part of family just to fold. So you try to support them through this difficult time. And that's what I think they try to do. What you need, the new leader needs to understand that, but maybe there should be a leeway to allow them to invest, because also the promises you made. Because if you have much more uncertainty on the government, because people don't see something happening, there will be some uproar as well. So what we need to do is find a way in which you give them opportunity to pay back over a longer period of time, allows them to invest to things they promised, and generate jobs, investment, create jobs, which then pays back through taxation. And that's how I would hope to see
well,
happen.
With all that's happening within Europe, your leader doesn't seem keen to negotiate and just stay on as it is. Do you think that that's a good idea?
What do you mean?
He wants to stay within the Europe as it is. He's not up for the referendum. He's not up for having a negotiation.
Look, what you're doing is same thing as like having a referendum for Scotland. Look, having that promise, whoever promised, promising a referendum for Scotland brought so much uncertainty, and you've seen what it would have meant. And when you have like uncertainty with Europe, it's like you can't, you know, there are things that you can't go and say, well, clearly I want to change my mind, we signed up to something. It's like this, the loan. You signed up to some, you know, conditions and stuff. Now you're saying, well, I don't like it, I want to change it and I want to negotiate it. Well, actually, I'm sorry, tough luck. It doesn't work like that. The world doesn't work like that. But it's opportunities for votes, because there are people who are anti-Europe and they want those votes.
But
and
I think that's negotiated, though. Greece will negotiate it at some point.
I mean, I think they will negotiate the loan terms.
But they might not get
stuff.
Out of it. Yeah.
They won't. I think that's different. But I do feel that what Ed's point is, look, we are in Europe. We need to make sure that the European community, because what it does, when you put an uncertainty, everybody who does business with UK, if you're not part of Europe. That's it. You just come out of Europe. You know, we had a referendum. We want to stay in Europe or not? And we said, no, we're not going to stay in Europe. Mm-hmm. The business, all these people who have properties from, you know, the Russians, Hong Kong, whatever properties, there's a huge collapse of all this because they sell them and cash in. And that will have huge impact on British economy, employment, all that. We cannot risk that. People, we owe it to the people of this country. We cannot risk it in that way for political opportunism. And that's what I see
happening. Let me ask
happening.
Chris, your leader has said that we're going to have a referendum in 2017, and he's going to negotiate before that. I mean, if all this is happening, it's not a good picture, is it, in terms of economy? The only thing he's probably going to negotiate that some Polisky's daughter or son not having their benefit taken over to Poland. And that's about it, isn't it? Does it really matter?
No, I think it is really fundamental to the future. I mean, I myself, you know, Europe is a great peace project. Let's not forget that. We do have great historical partnerships with countries such as Greece. We all are going through a tough time at the moment. But I think really what the nation is going to be about is, you know, we want to keep those trade relationships. They are critical. To our future. It's our biggest market on our doorstep. But really, I think what we need to do is make sure that we have that two-track element in there, that you have that core Eurozone, that in order to cope with these huge challenges they're facing, they're going to have to come closer together. But then you've got the periphery nations like the UK, who maybe don't want to get involved in a federalised project. and have that bit of distance. And I think that's really important in how we shape it forward. The UK is a key force in Europe. We shouldn't forget we are one of the great European civilizations. Mm. We're a great force for liberty and democracy. You know, we need to reach out to the likes of Eastern Europe, Central Europe, who do look to the UK for a lot of leadership. You know, their heritage, they came out from communism, their experience of the left there, and they're now built their economies. You know, we are a real force to promote that on Europe. But I do think because of the scale of the challenges countries such as Greece are facing, you are going to have that divide. And therefore, for the UK to make sure that itself looks after its strategic interests, that as well as keeping open with our family of nations across Europe, that we have that divide and negotiate the way we move forward.
I was just going to say, look, I mean, if you want to reform Europe, you don't have to have a referendum to do that. You could still, you know, be, because what you do, you,
I think the referendum is in or out. I mean, if you want to stay,
yeah, and that's quite, and as I said, that's quite dangerous. I mean, one of the key things I see is that you want to be in the, you know, you want to be the striker, not or watch it from the sideline, and so that you have
economically, England is the striker because Russians are still buying in England. Rich Greeks are still buying in England. They're not buying anywhere else.
What I meant is when you in a game, when you want to be on the top table, yeah, and you want to have people who have huge, who feel that you will be at the core of Europe and to shape and shake Europe, not somebody actually will look. We will be there if we have our. Otherwise, we'll be out. You're not going to have a lot of friends to help you or support you to change that you need. So and that's what you need. You need to have allies. And when you're not really sure you want to be in, you're not going to get many allies who want to support you the changes that you want. And that's what I think.
So if you hold government in May, are you going to withdraw from the referendum? Would your party withdraw from the referendum?
We haven't promised a referendum, have we?
But you haven't, but there's a parliamentary act that there will be a referendum in 2017. Will you change that if you hold?
Well, that's not in our party policy, is it?
It's not in your party policy.
If I just say on the referendum,
I don't think they can.
I can't comment on that.
But you can negate,
what I would say about this referendum is, without a doubt, the issue of European membership is a key issue for a large element of the electorate out there. And it is an issue that needs to be resolved because this has been hanging around. And actually, it means the UK is in a situation. We're one of the big three nations in Europe, along with Germany and France, where we've got one foot in and one foot out.
But Germany's in a bit of a pickle anyway, isn't it?
Germany's in the pickle, but we ourselves, we need to make that decision and finally say we're committing to this or we're doing whatever, because then we're going to have the most productive relationship.
Because Merkel
we
is
need
already
to sell
having,
the issue. We need
Merkel
to sell
is
the
already
issue.
Having opposition, just knowing that Greece might not pay.
Alternative for Deutschland is obviously expanding
and then France,
rapidly there. Yeah.
They're charging about 75% in income tax.
Well, again, I think this stresses the need for reform. You've got that core area that undoubtedly needs further consolidation to cope with these massive challenges. And then you've got the periphery nations. We need to sort this out. We need to have this debate. Mm. We need to come forward with a package that the British people can have a final say on.
But look, the referendum doesn't really, is not needed. I mean, what does the referendum say? People either want to be in or we want to be out. I mean, that's the referendum. I think when you go and negotiate, if you can't get anywhere, you say to people, well, I think it's not worth, the British Prime Minister should say, I believe in it's not in British interest, and I'm supporting, and no, I want endorsement from the people of this country, and that's what I want to see, a British Prime Minister saying that. Well, at the moment, I don't see the current Prime Minister saying, actually, I'm going to have a referendum, and I'm going to ask to get out or stay in. He's not saying any of that because there's an election. I think you need somebody straight, transparent, say, I'm going to say we're going to go stay in, I'm going to campaign for staying in. That doesn't happen, and I think people see through that.
Are you going to respond to that?
Look, we're quite clear. We want a reformed EU. The UK will then get that package, put it to the British people saying, do you want to stay in a reformed EU, which we're in favour of. We've come out and saying, you know, we want to reform the EU and to stay in with the partnership, or you can pull out. Being quite
what
clear
he's saying
about
is that your Prime Minister is not going to able to give the referendum and not able to negotiate.
Oh, he is going to be able to do that.
He's in a better
situation. We're already, look, Europe is in a critical situation. They're open to engagement. We're going to reform it. And, you know, there we go. We can move forward.
The Greece Finance Minister, during his tour, the first country he's come to is England. he's opened up his tour with England first. Simultaneously, Merkel, the German Chancellor, is saying that, you know, hopefully we will able to negotiate and get Cameron what he wants and we get what we want. So there is a momentum picking up, isn't it, within the British Prime Minister that he will able to negotiate.
No, but look, I mean, like any...
But he's not going to negotiate now up until the election.
Because I think what the Greeks are trying to do is saying, look, you know, Cameron has one foot out, the Prime Minister, and one foot in. We want to get out, and I think it's better to have a coalition with those people who will be anti-Europe. I think they're just building a coalition of anti-Europeans. I mean, that's what's happening. I think that's the picture. So if you're more anti-Europe, then this is the first point of call of this the finance minister is to Britain. I mean, that's a bit coincidence, isn't it?
I don't think
it?
Any big party is anti-Europe except for UKIP. And they're... bit of a hypocrite from my point of view, because they are taking the European salary anyway.
Well, the finance minister they're making a lot of money off the taxpayer.
Seems to have a lot of problem. The current finance minister, who I think is one of the right parties and from the independent party of Greece, and he has a huge trouble with the you know the German Chancellor and other people. I mean, they have real problem, and I think for him to come to Britain first is an interesting.
I think he's come to Britain. Part of the reason first is obviously we're leading the way in the world.
Because
in the recovery, we're such a huge
strong.
Yeah, we've come through. We've come through fighting. Actually, you know, it's been a tough 5 years. We're coming through, and obviously he's come and saying, "How has Britain done it?"
Hold on. When you say coming through, I mean, you know, when I talk to people on doorsteps, you know, and when I hear people, you know, having huge difficulty in paying the, you know, the elderly people paying their heating bills, paying, you know, covering the cost, or, you know, the bedroom tax.
But it depends on which doorstep you're going to, isn't it?
Look, so. I mean, there are. I mean, what I think is happening is this current government actually has looked after the few, but at the expense of putting austerity measures on many. And you know, people who are over time, if you look at what we, I mean, you know, VAT, you know, increasing VAT, and actually, these are people like, you know, who go and shop, and ordinary people have to do their daily stuff, and they're having to pay. But then you've got tax cuts for the millionaires, and so that's slightly different priorities. I don't think this government coming to learn anything from the current government here, because if the left are coming to learn from here, I would be surprised. I think it's trying to get some support for some of the changes they want to see in Europe. So because at the moment, Britain is alone. So, I mean, they also benefit having somebody else on their side too.
Is Britain alone under this Prime Minister?
I don't think Britain is alone. I don't think it's alone in Europe. You know, we've been engaging a lot with our European partners on security issues, on the economy. You know, we're coming through it. I think, you know, the global economy is not out of the woods yet. It has been a tough 5 years, I would accept that. I, like many of us, had periods of unemployment, you know, lived in circumstances I wouldn't want. We stuck to that plan, and we're coming through to the cusp of it to keep it going. But because otherwise, we're going to face chaos and confusion. We need to keep to that plan.
At the beginning of your government's financial plan, Lagarde, the IMF chief, said they were very worried.
Yeah, well, so, she's changed her words, hasn't she? She says Britain is leading the way a few months ago. Yeah, she
in what
said
terms?
That. You know, in terms of the economy, in terms of the plan they're delivering, in terms of employment, it's moving ahead. I would accept there's still a cost of living problem. You know, there is a problem there in people aren't feeling the wages. As the Prime Minister says, Britain deserves a pay rise. But if you look in Poplar and Limehouse, my own area, over 10,000 more people in work. We've taken nearly 6,000 people out of tax. And we've cut taxes for over 50,000 people. We are delivering, meaning hardworking families have over £700 a year more in their pocket. You know, it is delivering there. It's taking a while, but we need to keep on to that plan. Otherwise, we face, you know, a really bad situation.
Chris is saying that, you know, basically he's simultaneously kind of agreeing with you that cost of living is a bit high. But is it not true that at the present time, cost of living is the least at the moment, with inflation being down, interest rate being down, oil price being down, you know, so everything's down, council tax being frozen.
The oil price has nothing to do with the government, basically.
Of course it is.
But look, can I just, I mean, look, I mean, one of the things about employment, clearly the employment, you know, you can't deny the figures that have gone up. But the reality of it is that it is part-time jobs on low income. People are having to take up jobs because of the draconian policies of this government on the benefit services, that people are being punished unnecessarily sometimes. You know, we've seen that, and they're getting zero-hour contracts. You know, it's quite unacceptable that when you've got a family and you're on a zero contract, you don't know what you're going to be earning next day or the hours and stuff. It is not the kind of, you know, country that
so
we are. We're British, you know. We could
places
do
like
far
Greece,
better than
if
this.
You look at places like Greece, don't you think that having zero-hour contract would have been much better than having no contract at all?
No, you have to, look, what you have to do is
at
create
least
employment.
They were having, you know.
I mean, I think the way that what they may have done is Australia is trying to follow this country here. My only benefit here is that the Labour government, by saving the banks, by bailing the banks out, you know, saved this country from the ruin where they having to have the whole of Europe to bank, bail them out rather than them trying to do that. And
Chris,
that's the difference.
Did Labour bail out the banks and rescued the economy?
We
30
did.
Seconds. We're going
well,
to
there's no doubt that Labour left one of the worst economic situations for a government to inherit. In recent memory. But going back to some of those earlier points, I think the fact that there's nearly, you know, nearly 2,000 people less on Job Seekers Allowance in Popper and Limehouse since 2010, that's a fact to be welcomed. We're getting people off welfare, getting them into work, and we need to keep on that journey.
Well, thank you, Chris. Thank you, Motimbe.
Sridharsha
Mondali, we were talking about Greece and Europe, and when you have local politicians, they all come back to local issues. So we tour around the Europe and Greece. We end up here in Poplar and Limehouse and Bethnal Green Bow. Sridhar Shumuli, I'm going to break to break it. I'm going to talk to Sridharsha Mondali, thank you for staying with us. This is our third and final segment, and we will be talking about Scotland and devolution. Before we go into that, again, I'm reminding you about our quiz, and the quiz will scroll again. It's on the quiz is, when did Greece declare independence from the Ottoman Empire? Was it 1822, 1722, 1622? Please do email your answer to us on the email that's coming up. It's pnb@channelieurope.tv. Coming up with a bit of cold, Chris?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Been out on the campaign trail.
Leafleting
and whatnot.
So,
yeah.
Scotland devolution, as we all know, that was the promise that they will get more power before the referendum. To be honest with you, they're sure enough promise because they only got 35% of the vote, less than 35% of the vote. The No campaign won by staggering 46%. But what do you think, Motimbe? Do you think that it's a good thing to have more power locally, especially a place like Scotland?
Well, look, I mean, for me, that's my personal opinion. I mean, I would want to make sure every person across the UK has the equal opportunity. And because we are all Britain and British, yeah? So everybody should have the same opportunity, not have different opportunities when you cross a kind of a line, a dividing line. And that's something that I feel that every child, wherever you grow, that you have the same opportunity in education, opportunities in jobs and so on. And that's what Britain should be offering. What this referendum, and I think all parties have made a promise, and that's as a result, you know, I think Lord Smith from Kelvin is, who was given the responsibility by the Prime Minister to draw up the plan for the legal legislative process for those devolved powers that they promised, and having taxation powers as well. And it's like an independent country, one of the probably few, you know, sort of regions which have so much power, not in Europe, and probably the only.
It's not as independent as Scotland and the others are. They still have the flag, the British flag on the corner, but it will still be within UK, but it's just a little bit of more power.
Well, it has a lot of power, because if you look at, you know, being able to flexibility to change the benefit system as well as, you know, the taxation and vary that and all that. So it's a huge power for a country, and the health service as well. What my worries are is how that replicates, and we already see that this whole thing, them and us, English and Welsh, Scots and us. I think this whole thing about division and dividing us as a country by politicians now, you know, I think everybody's responsible for that. We shouldn't do this, because that makes us weaker. Mm. Because what it does is we have to fight the world. We have to fight the European Union, European. And the more divided we are in our own selves for our own political opportunism, we are leaving ourselves exposed to be weak when we try to go negotiate things for the country, because they'll think, actually, you're not united. Wales doesn't want it. Scotland doesn't want it. You're speaking for your English county or a Scottish country. Mm. So I believe that the path that we have gone is not a wise one. But now that we are in that path, what we need to do is make sure that if you make promises in any political people, we deliver the promises we made. We need to make sure, where possible, that, you know, there are common endeavours that we come together that makes this country a great place, and we can do far better than we are doing at the moment.
Before I come to Chris, you said they're going to have power over a benefit system. I don't think they're having that, and I don't think they want it either. Well, they're having other powers, like taxation, fuel tax, passenger tax, keeping income tax, stamp duty they're doing. They actually changed their stamp duty system. But I don't think
I think what you're saying is the universal the credit system is not. That's going to be a night wrong.
Yeah.
But what it does is, if Scotland wants to give somebody an additional benefit for being disabled or some whatever, they'll be allowed to give it.
There'll be
opportunities for, you know, things that are not available here. There will be.
I think those kind of things, if you look at it on a micro micro level, even Tower Hamlets has a budget of $500,000 to spare to dish out. Okay, you're in a stuck position. Yeah. I'm here to help you. I think so, because it's Scotland, they might have a $5 billion.
Well, that's slightly different because Tower Hamlets doesn't have ability to tax people as much as
I know
want.
It doesn't. But
probably through council tax, it probably does.
You're absolutely right. But it does budget in a fraction of the money. If somebody's in a rainy day and somebody's disabled,
taxation system, you could then be able to.
Yeah, that's why I
said
they might have it in a billion. And I'm saying that's on a micro level, a very small area where Scotland probably can, you know, touch and go kind of thing. But overall, the benefit system, everything stays with the UK, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong. I think that is the case. They haven't got, and they don't want it, as far as I know. They don't want the benefit system on their shoulder. They want to keep it within the UK.
We can't afford to fudge this issue. Mm. I think if we come back to the central point, is we can't afford, for our union, let's not forget we're the Conservative and Unionist Party, from our perspective, can't afford to move forward without a sustainable platform for us to engage with each other. And I think really, you know, the Scottish referendum showed that whilst they lost it, there is a powerful force there that says they want more self-determination. But at the same time, in response to that, there has been an awakening in England. So today you'd have seen a lot of debate around English votes for English laws and the issues of vetoes. And I think we really need to get to grips with this issue and say, look, how do we come together as the UK? How do we make sure for the next 50-100 years we can have a future where we're working with each other without this horrible division that is arising? And therefore, you know, I think it is important that we put the plan in place. We have this veto that we've been talking about today for English MPs to make a decision, and that for those big issues that affect us as a country, such as security matters, the future direction of relationships, trade negotiations, that sort of thing, that we do keep that within the Westminster Parliament. But for those smaller issues, we do have a bit more devolution.
But how do you think, I mean, what is your view in the broader perspective? Where does it stop? Or is it going to spread out to other areas, other provinces like Wales, Ireland, even as far as I think Mayor Boris is talking about having a London revolution.
Personally, I think we need to keep it to the
Birmingham is talking
the,
about
the
it,
nations, you know. I think so. Wales,
keep it in one
England,
place.
Scotland, Northern Ireland. Yeah, I think keeping it in there, having the Westminster Parliament there, but having that kind of, maybe, you know, verging on a federated structure that is feeding into there. Because I think actually, if you go down and you start to say all these other areas should have it, and they're already talking about some areas are going to start issuing bonds and all that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Okay, great, but we need to have some firm
US
direction to keep going.
Does
the US does, and but I think we need to make sure there is a degree of control on it, and let's not forget, let's not create whole new bureaucracies, new forums, more taxpayer-funded politicians and bureaucrats in all these different assemblies when a lot of this infrastructure is already there. Look at our local councillors, look at what local councils can decide. Do we need a whole other layer of bureaucracy, of elected politicians, when actually the real issue is people out there want the people who are already in their jobs to be doing their jobs? Mm-hmm. And so that's
I was going to say, this clever strategy by this Prime Minister, current Prime Minister, and I say clever, mm-hmm. is to this whole thing about this English and Scottish, you know, why should the Scottish have a vote in our English thing?
I think it's the Prime Minister, I think it's the
backbenchers
and the other.
No, the backbenchers, but look, it's instigating political, and you've got you know, Mr. Hague also on the bandwagon. But let me just tell you what the trick, what's behind it. Behind it is that the English MPs should have a vote on things. So imagine you've got Ed Miliband, the Prime Minister, and you've got the English MPs have a vote on something. Well, we might not have a majority on the English MPs. So they could just oust the Prime Minister, undermine the Prime Minister, because although he might have the overall majority, but not enough English MPs. So the politics here is slightly weird, and I think this is going to be a fundamental problem with how the Constitution works. And I think we just really need to think through this, because this shouldn't be the way politics
should
be.
According to the poll, you probably have more English MPs for Labour than in Scotland.
I'm just telling you, that's why I think that's the strategy.
As I said at the outset, we can't afford to fudge this issue, and it's about fairness. Are we going to have a situation where a Scottish government says we're going to cut income tax, then Scottish MPs vote to raise income tax in England to subsidise them? Jim Murphy, the Scottish Labour Party leader, has already said he wants to tax Londoners extra to fund Scottish nurses. So it's about fairness. It's about drawing a line and saying, look, OK, we want to move forward together. We want to have a sustainable future. How do we do it? How do we get the mechanics in? And we need to look at these issues.
Sure. The other thing that I want to ask you guys is that your views on this. Before the referendum, Alex Salmond and the SNP was bigging up this oil thing. That we've got Northern Sea oil made out of this, just like the Middle East countries and America and this and that. But after the referendum, the oil has come down below $50
barrels.
Had he had the government,
bankrupt.
He would have been
another Greece.
Much
another Greece.
Yeah, another Greece on our doorstep.
He probably would have had a bit of a pick of this.
And that's
chambers. So again, it comes back to the earlier debate we had, I mean discussion we had on the first round, that politicians say things, and imagine if he had this, he would have had to come back and ask for money.
I mean, one of the key things is that nearly 1.6 million people who voted to have the independence, and it's a huge number of people, 1.6 million I think around there, and we had about 2 million who said no. I mean, I think it was about 45 and then 55 who said yes. I think key problem for us is really is the benefit of the union, and that's what the Scottish people should realise, that had they not said to stay no to this, then we broke up, and as you said, they would be in major problem. They will depend on the oil, and that was the trigger.
Yeah.
We got the oil and we could run the country.
And
because at the end of the day, and what I understand is that they do get a large share more per head on that, because of course, you know, you want to make sure that if it's bigger areas and cost, and I do feel that you know, we've proven right. You can't just rely on oil, and oil runs out sooner or later, or what happens, the economic situation changes, and that's why you need that link. And it, you know, we benefit by having Scotland. We're stronger outside UK, and those things matter when you have, you know, you represented the world stadium in sports or whatever, it's much more powerful.
And I mean, Nicola Sturgeon in her interview said that you know, one of her pledges to be prime minister, first minister of Scotland, is that we're going to have another referendum. Mm-hmm. So how many referendums can Scotland keep on having? And is it a bargaining chip that every time they want something, they're just going to pick up and say, we're going to have a referendum?
Yeah, it's one of the great questions posed by the referendum. And what people are waking up to is it was by no means a final say on the matter. We are entering a new era where there is going to be a whole host of other bargaining. Ultimately, I have to say, I mean, it's for the Scottish people to decide. You know, we're entering this situation, if it's going to happen, and as long as the SNP are a popular force, that will happen. But as we've just said, one of their major planks for their future was oil. Look what's happened there. So people have to draw their own conclusions, but I think it is, without a doubt, it's going to be a feature. It's part of the furniture.
I mean, what do you think the future holds within Scotland? Will they be able to, with all this power in their hand now, they can do their own taxation, own stamp duty, and a whole lot of things that they can do. Do you think that they're in the right track? Eventually they'll be okay? I mean, the population will grow at the same time. Do you think that they can sustain with the NHS and with this, and currently they're doing free education for higher education? Do you think that this is all going to come down? Because you are now taking responsibility in your own hands.
Well, I think what's opportunity for us, I mean, obviously, is to learn from each other. There are some good practices in England, and Scotland also have some good practices. And they will obviously go through a new, because remember when they first had the powers, there was a big hiccup with the exam results and stuff. Went to the wrong people and stuff. So what we need to do is make sure the transition of the legislative process, whoever is in government, because it will be the next prime minister who has to take these legislative process through the parliament and take it to going to have it, you know, the royal assent on those. And once that happens, and making sure the implementation is there, and because all parties sign up to this, it's important that everybody supports that and not use it for political. And I'm quite sure near to the election there will be some of that. But the reality is, once that's gone over, whoever's prime minister, let's support that. Make the people of Scotland make sure the government delivers and has the infrastructure to deliver it properly to the people of Scotland. We owe it to the people because they're part of us. And we shouldn't really, wherever possible, we shouldn't divide being Scottish or whatever. I mean, I'm proud to be a British person, and I see that whole of Scotland and England as one. I mean, if I see that as one.
The only thing I would say that kind of came out really well, Chris, is that England had its first prime minister, a female prime minister, and after the referendum, Scotland's got its first female first minister.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Do you feel that your government played a role in this?
Hamid, that could see where that comes from.
Or Jim Murphy, you know, played a part in
it. Well, you're the one responsible for getting her. I mean, look, you know, look what you put up. And she wants full in Bibendis as well, by the way.
I couldn't possibly comment.
I mean, what else can we say? I mean, that is a good thing, isn't it? That the SNP has now got a female leader at the end.
Equality is a massive issue.
And she has managed to, bring everybody, the Scotland together. Mm-hmm. Which is good.
We have some, across all parties, there's some senior politician, female politician. They're amazingly, really good.
We're probably entering into a different debate altogether.
Yeah.
I mean, so when is Labour going to bring in their first female leader?
Look, we're proud to have the first Bengali MP here in Tower Hamlets, and I'm sure we're leading the way, and you never know.
In terms of female leader of the party in the next parliament?
Well, time will tell. We've got Ed Miliband, who is an amazing person, who genuinely you know, cares about the people of this country.
After Ed Miliband, who do you think?
Ed Miliband will be the prime minister, and there's no option. There's no vacancy at the moment, so we can't talk about speculate, okay. Can we? I mean, there's no vacancy at the moment, is
okay.
there?
Chris, mm-hmm. I mean, in terms of the NHS, mm-hmm. do you think... Scotland is not that bad, is it, in at present moment? And they said they're going to do more improvement. I mean, Jim mm-hmm. Murphy's saying mm-hmm. he's going to take money over from here to invest in there, which is all good for Scotland. Mm-hmm. In terms of Wales, do you think that... You know, the NHS is very poorly there. And do you think that if they had a devolution and they would have had their own kind of way of doing it, they could have done better? So it could have been
well,
good
obviously,
if you spread out the devolution.
Health is already devolved in Wales. You know, that's already a matter for them.
Okay.
You know,
but
they've
I'm
been
saying
recording
in terms
that.
Of taxation and others, they probably would have been able to spend more money.
You know, I think... we can't get away from they already have some fund powers. Health is a devolved matter there. They have a substantial grant and they've had the controller there. This issue about tax and all this sort of thing, you know, comes again. We can't afford to fudge it. We do need to have these kind of discussions mm-hmm. over the coming months. And, you know, we need to talk about how we give a fair balance for everyone within the UK. So I think, you know, that comes within that.
It's very difficult to have a fair balance, isn't it? First, you want your power and you want your money, and then you're saying, well, I can't maintain, I want more money. And
well, look, I mean, I
and some
I
people
can't
are just
laugh when,
stay together, look, but
balance.
There's still problems in
look,
other provinces.
Look, this is what the interpretation I said we will have to interpret the Conservative policy. Because no, but the Conservatives won't interpret it. Well, we will interpret. And so let me interpret Conservative policy on NHS. NHS will not be what it is or was in the future. Labour introduced NHS to this country, and we will be the one who will protect it and save it. That's the bottom line. And
in terms of
balance,
Wales,
I think in terms of balance, you talked about balance.
In terms of Scotland and Wales, because in Wales, it's your party who's running it.
Look,
it's not Conservatives.
Look, the Conservative Party is the one who gives us the money through a formula, and it cuts the public services by huge
cuts. But the formula
cuts.
Is still going to be there if you hold Parliament.
So, but the fact is, it cuts it by huge. I mean, what the Labour government will do is give more money for getting more nurses, more doctors, more people are there, and protecting the social care which is needed in order to make sure the beds are not blocked. What I would say is that the balance is making sure everybody gets the same opportunity in life. What you don't do is basically say, well, actually, you know, the richer you are, the more we support you to get more, and the poorer you are, we'll take more.
I don't think that's the
case. That's not balance.
I don't think that's the case. Every government will look into that kind of fairness. 30 seconds. What do you want to...
On the
respond,
NHS?
Respond to
we've
that.
Safeguarded funding. Next year, there'll be £2 billion extra for care in the community. And actually, if we look at North East London, again, bringing it back local, we've got 850 more doctors since 2010. You know, we've had tough decisions. It has been a tough time. But we're coming through. We're safeguarding public services. And we're delivering for Britain.
Thank you, Chris. No, thank you, Motinbhai. We're finished. So you can come back in another program. Shri Darshakmandali, thank you. I want to share Thakar Junior, Apra Ashwin আমাদের ডিসকাশন আশা করি আমাদের সাথে নেক্সট উইক আবার আসবেন নেক্সট উইক আমাদের সাথে আছেন আজম ভাই থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ
থ্যাংক ইউ আসসালামু আলাইকুম
ওয়েল ডান